certainly again, Saturday afternoon, and see all the familiar faces here. I think that's really encouraging. You heard a ton of great information. Not going to reiterate, because I certainly want to get to the questions and answer. The reason that we're here on the panel is for the marketing alternatives. And many of you know the Homestead Meat story in the area, six local ranchers that have been together for 20 years now and marketing their product jointly, took it the next step and have recently, not recently, I guess 5 years has seemed like recent, but it's not, purchased different processing plants, and now have a USDA processing plant here in Delta. Just last week we were able to actually take one of the enterprises that and shift it to someone else that had a special opportunity, and so the wild game processing will be someone else's lovely opportunity now up in the Miami area. We will concentrate on Delta and providing the high quality food for the consumers here in this area. We do market to Denver. We do market to the resort areas. We recently stopped doing the farmer's market for some of the same reasons that you heard George talk about yesterday. We did that up in Aspen, Grand Junction, several other places. But at the end of the day, when you calculated all of the return, we have started to build and have a relationship with the consumer, but the return and doing the farmer's market every Saturday and every Sunday just wasn't there. But again, we wouldn't trade not doing the farmer's market, because that's how we built the relationship. That's how we were able to tell the story of Homestead Meats and again, build that relationship. So doing the farmer's market was the right thing to do, but it was also the right thing to do to merge that off and just concentrate on a local store here, right adjoining the packing plant, and then continue the relationships with the individuals that we have over in the Denver area, and Telluride and Aspen and Glenwood. So again, I want to get to the questions. I don't want to take up a ton of time, but many of you are familiar with the story, but it's hard to believe that it's been 20 years now that we've been doing this.
Can you hold the microphone?
Along with my wife and I bought sand on the Eastman farm in a way to Colorado. We raised grass-fed beef, natural bed pork, and we also have about an acre of lavender that we make half a dozen different types of lavender products, lotions and soaps, and market locally. If that's not enough to be diverse, last year, 2 years ago, we got into the bee business. That was the subject. But anyway, we don't really call ourselves beekeepers. We are beehappers. We have a pretty good and we are beekeeping. Anyway, that's one of the most interesting parts of what we do is the bees and learning about them and what they do and teaching our grandkids about that. It's a lot of fun to take the grandkids out there and put in bee suits and open up the beehive and talk about it. They can tell their friends and friends come over and do it all over again. But after our beef, we sell mostly packaged beef to individuals, four different restaurants in the Montrose area. And thanks to Homestead Beef here in Delta, we can get our beef packaged there and sell to these commercial markets. I don't know what else to say about our farm, but I'm welcome to any questions you have.
Who has the first question for us?
Hi, Robbie. This one's for you. Do you what types of animals? Sheep, cows, other types of animals do you process? You know, for USDA.
Goats, pork, sheep, beef. Is what we'll process there.
Okay, so we could bring our animals to you and you would process them so we can sell them to restaurants?
Yes, absolutely. We co-pack, and so anybody that sells to either direct or to a restaurant, a lot of times they'll require the USDA bug with your label on it. We will help walk you through that process with the label review board, because your label will have to have our establishment number on it. And so we do that for several individuals. Now, some do not require that. Some restaurants don't. If you sell across the counter at any facility, though, most of them will. And so that's part of the added value that we do with the COPAC, and is walking through that label review board process.
Perfect. Thank you.
Another question?
I have a small farm beyond that.
Can you hold the mic closer?
Yeah, we can't hear.
Sorry. I have a small farm beyond that, family farm. There's a lot of other very, very similar farms in the North Fork Valley. And one of the challenges we have is access to labor that still make it affordable as an economic unit. And so what ends up happening is, working 10, 12 hours a day, 7 days a week. And that includes the rent working customers and things like that. Recently, I'm aware of a number of collaborative models where groups of farmers such as you described all got together and try to pool their interests, get some economies of scale associated with that, kind of help the small. Can you all describe some more successful collaborative models that have been out there, and why they're more successful when you see some of the other co-ops in those types of arrangements fail after 1 or 2 years?
Well, my advance, I don't know why they failed, because I haven't met so far. You mentioned something, though. One of the first things you have to sell is generational family farms. Something I haven't mentioned in some of my questions. Sells big time. Pictures of the family sell big time. Yeah, I mean, simply, by aggregating, you shouldn't not only think about aggregating for sales, aggregating for your labor pool. Maybe you can get 5 because everybody doesn't have to have the same labor at the same time. You can have a labor pool and share it around the farms. So once you've established yourself as a group, and you can go on any place, and in 5 minutes you can become an LLC. Okay? So you can have a legal formation, you can form it, you can ask somebody voluntarily, apply for whatever to man it, you can develop a website, you can do that in another 10 minutes, and all of a sudden you've got a lot of the components that fit into the marketing your story. And so I think recognizing what's available in technology today should get you over possibly those that are failing today. They're not utilizing the technology, understanding their customer.
So when you read a lot of the literature about co-ops and why they fail, and it's really interesting. And it's something that our group has struggled with, even though there's only 6 of us. There's 6 different opinions. There's, sometimes that means there's actually 6 families, so there's actually 24 different versions of what should be done. And so a lot of times, the reason they fail is just not taking the time to say, are we still going in the right direction? I mean, there's several times our group has been better off if we haven't talked to each other for about 3 months, because then we still focus on the big picture and we're not trying to micromanage some of the day-to-day. And that may sound a little contrary to the constant communication, but again, that's where you got to keep going back to the big picture. We're there to provide a safe, wholesome food for this area. We made a conscious decision not to have it so extraordinarily priced that it was just for the Aspen market, because we knew that the majority of our market was right here locally. too quickly, and then too many people's versions of what should be happening. It's never easy, even when it's a small group. So that's what, and I know they're, I don't know if they were here, the Rocky Mountain Farmers Union individual that was here, you know, he has a ton of resources for why co-ops fail, but I've heard him talk several times, and it goes back to just some of the highlights we just hit on.
I had this discussion just last week with a man who's trying to form a co-op hub for the Montrose Farmers Market. And I told him it would work if he could co-op with some of these mountain towns where the food prices are higher, where they're willing to pay. Montrose and Delta just won't sustain those kind of prices that a farmer needs to make any money at. Another thing that needs to be overcome, and this is real hard, is farmer independence. That I have to independent, not willing to work with other farmers at some point, so I'm doing it the way I want to do it. So we need to get over that and quit thinking about ourselves and thinking about the group when we join something like that. So I would encourage, if you want to talk to me later about that, I've got the guy's phone number, but I'll share that with you. And maybe there's
can I ask a question leading into that on farmer independence? And we've all come together to hear about Salt Health and think about Salt Health and engage that idea and figure out we are all now going to do it on our land. Here within this region, are there ways that farmers can dialogue? Are there either formal or informal ways that those who are keen on putting Salt Health in place, making it work, swapping the ideas about what didn't work or what did work? Does that exist here or can it exist? Or is it just everybody's got to bump along and do it themselves and whatever successes they have and help them there?
I think we can, but we need to get rid of the word sustainable. I looked it up a little while ago. The first definition says able to be maintained at a certain rate and level. Well, I don't think that's good enough. I think we need to be better than that, and not just to be able to maintain it at a certain level. If that was the case, I wouldn't be married for 36 and a half years. But anyway, you've got to learn to change and grow and diversify and be open to change.
I do think you hit upon something that we've talked about several times. I mean, even in just Delta County, there is a divide when we talk about, it's not just over to Denver. I mean, there's a divide in Delta County when it comes to agriculture. And I always tell people, we have to talk about all of ag. All of ag is everyone's viewshed. When you look, if you're on Sucker Mesa and you look across to the whole valley and you look down over to the San Juans and you look over to the Upper Quadrant and you come back up to the Grand Mesa, all of that is everyone's viewshed, and that's all of ag. It's not just a certain segment of ag. And so I do think, especially in the Central West Slope, we cannot keep going down the road, well, this is my version of ag, and this is your version of ag. If you farm on California Mesa, why, you're just plain evil. We've got to get away from that. And that's where we have to say that really and truly, it's all of ag. And that means all the North Fork and all of ag, Montrose and Grand Junction. It contributes to the viewshed. And we've talked about it. There's diversity. How many times is diversity up on the chart over there? Did anybody keep a tally of how many times diversity was used the last 2 days? There's not one type of ag that fits. It's going to take all of ag to feed, and we know that. Now we're going to evolve into an ag that actually is, for lack of a better word, able to keep going. And whether you say that's sustainable, I don't get it hung up on those labels, but I truly want the conversation in this county to move away from a certain type of ag. And sorry, that was a soapbox.
Is there a way to push that conversation, not just a certain type of ag, but
a bag. I mean, again, we heard a ton of information how we can move in that direction. And let's not put labels. Again, I don't think we did that here in the last 2 days. I didn't hear that. You've got the whole spectrum of ag represented right here. You absolutely do. So it starts right here with this group, with the Soil Conservation District, with DCED, concentrating on soil health, but let's not let soil health keep getting pigeonholed either. And that's gonna take some work. But as far as the conversation, that's why I sound like a nag sometimes when I keep saying it's all about it when we have these different meetings. And I think we have to all do our part in this room to keep saying that. Because that's why, you know, we sell beef and we don't pay attention to the box size because everybody has a different version of the type of steak they want. Some people want a really thick, heavy marble steak. Some people want a thin, lightly marble steak. Some want a 17-inch eye, some want a 5-inch eye. We don't pay attention to the size of the box. That's why I think we've got to get away from sometimes my version of soil health and your version of soil health. This was a great conversation because it has the full spectrum, and we all move towards something that is better able to keep going. And that was a long-winded answer to your question, and I apologize.
Other questions?
There's an organization called Local Farms First. I don't know if you've heard about that. It's actually Jeff Armstrong, Abundant Life, up in on Rogers Mesa is the drop-off point. It's a website where people can actually bid on your produce from, and it's mainly people in the Vail, Aspen, and Telluride area. And then you drop the produce off at Armstrong's and he takes it over there. And that's been going on for, I think, 2 or 3 years now. And it, I know some different people that are doing it and they're making money at it, so. I'm not sure the name of the website, do you?
Local Farms First is in restructuring right now, so it's really not really functioning. I've been partnering with the meeting in Peonia, and that went to a meeting last night about this. We're looking more, though as a small working group, in how to get product out of the valley. Not so much keeping it and selling it to people in the valley, because I'm not sure it's able to support. Enough people want that. But that's just someone else's coming song. But trying to pump it over to more destinations, maybe as far as the front range, but certainly over to Oregon, Oregon, down to Telluride and other places. So there will be postings about that. I think it develops further. You know, there's a young couple working on a business plan, and there's some drop standing and following and such to do it. So we all need it. I'm tired of them asking for us to be here. So, I'm new in the area. My name's Kay Robinson, and I have a 10-acre farm on that farm, Mesa Road. And it's hard here to get it out of the valley. You know, and I'd rather live somewhere where such fabulous food is being grown and it's not well known outside of the valley. And I'm sure I'm part of both of the Valley and Growers Association. And I try to take those brochures and give them out to customers. To the restaurants that sell food and such. But we're pretty well kept secret over here, or they know about us, but they don't know how to get the product. So except for the groups like the Homestead, ranchers have done an incredible job of going together and getting their goods out here. And a few of the fruit growers, but a lot of us have the smaller farms. Themselves trying to make it, and given that the margin is so narrow, and we're going to haul ourselves and pay fairly decent wages for all the labor, it's really tough to make it here. So we do have to get together, but I have not been around that because I'm sure I'm from Texas, so that farmers are independent customers, you know, as far as I'm concerned, at least all my uncles were. But there is at least a lot more conversation going on to try to get people together, to work together, to come up with, you know, viable business plans, marketing, to really have someone who's advocating what to sell what we have, because this valley is unbelievable in terms of what is grown up here. Now, I've got an nephew from Reno who works as a chef. He'll come up here, fill up his car truck full of line vegetables and they come back and sell them to the five-star restaurants and we under out here, we undersell ourselves over here. And we need a publisher longer.
What I'm hearing from you is exactly the cost value of the partnership the Montrose Farmers Market are working on.
Yeah.
So I encourage you to go on their website.
Okay.
Self-public in a store without it being USDA inspected by customers or otherwise, and they have to comply.
a yes business?
To your question, yes, there's beginning to be those that want to be able to say it but don't do it. And that's always an issue. Third-party certification is a big thing. Second thing is you just have to stay in leadership roles and leadership positions and keep putting your story out there as it is, the truth. And that, you know, those kind of things help. Back to the sustainability question, too. I'm not going to disagree with his version in his mind, absolutely. I would support that. The problem is that the marketplace now has come back to that word. It was deer in the headlights 12 years ago. Then it grew into and kind of got bastardized. Now it's come back and actually is very well accepted and understood in the marketplace. So, again, when you take your story to that market, as long as you are stepping outside of your values, and you're not saying that you're not sustainable, and you're not saying that sustainable is a bad term, you're just saying that it doesn't go far enough. It's an excellent way to phrase it, by the way, to say, I'm beyond sustainability, and you can go on, and then that excites them to ask for, and you start to give them your story for. So it's those kind of things, but sustainability is fairly successful today in the marketplace. It does get you in some doors, and the big boys are finally wrapping their arms around it, and that's how they're coming to us, because we're noted as a sustainable production system. You asked a couple more things in there, I'm not sure I'm getting them all.
That's interesting.
Yeah.
So my question is, how hard is it to do private label meat sales, and can I do it from my farm as well as to restaurants and customers outside of the area? I know homestead meats can do it, but when I try to find out what's involved, it's kind of like a bizarre circular journey in trying to figure out the rules and regulations. On one side, it sounds like it should be pretty simple, but then you start getting into all these, you know, handling issues and different rules and regulations. So, I mean, is it that hard to do, or is it not so hard to do?
So help me understand, are you saying that you just want to market direct to an individual in Denver, one of your animals?
I'd like to
be able to market to the customer what the customer wants in the way they want it. I know I can sell halves, quarters, wholes of beef, you know, but it's when you start getting down to, you know, individual packages or, you know, having the flexibility to provide what the customer wants and what different markets and different areas want. And you know, one example is to be able to sell at a farmer's market or to sell from a farm store on my farm or to sell over the internet through a website to somebody in Denver or New York City or LA and San Francisco. You know, just how complicated does that get?
Well, the simple answer is if you're not going to use USDA, then you have to sell, according to statute, you have to sell on a lightweight basis. And that's where it comes into the halves and the wholes and the quarters. That's in statute. Now, there's several groups working on trying to get state inspection. And if that goes through, then that would make that easier. The plants that currently under state inspection that are in the area could then package your product by the state, by the hamburger, that would allow you to do that. And there are several groups working on that. So there is a simple answer as far as you're not going through a USDA plant. You have to still do it by statute on the half quarter. Now, there's tons of product that moves everywhere that's not done that way. So, you know, la 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 la.
So I'm not sure if this is a question or more of a comment, but in line with the sustainability
And actually, I'm going to explain that because if you go to Dakota Lakes Research Station, as you drive into his farm, it's on the bottom of his sign, so I can't take credit for it, but we certainly leaned on that and used that very, very well in the marketplace today.
That's a great point. I think there's a ton of different definitions of the word sustainability. I mean, being there on the land and having that land produce an income for four generations is sustainable. Doing everything we've talked about here at the Soil Health Conference is sustainable. Maintaining your soil health and doing that is sustainable. So instead of getting twisted around the axle about a word, you know, talk about the story.
And one last question.
Well, not so much a question, just they words, I agree too. Words are very important, and those who can own the story, you know. What is the phrase? The survivors or the victims tell the story. Resilient as we go through more climate change is another word. Applies to food being resilient, or but there's got to be some way we can tell that story as a survival story, because that's the thing that's happening out here. Now you're talking about seeds, you're talking about soil, you're talking about, you know, having control over, you know, the larger companies that are corporations that are taking over our food at this point. So there's got to be some way put together a story that we all
can find. For the gentleman that was asking about the beef, go over and pick that guy at that restaurant, pick him up and bring him back to your ranch. Guaranteed. Once they get on your ground, once they get on your ranch, somebody said earlier they feared that, and I didn't follow up too much on that, but if you can get them to come and visit your ranch, sit at your lunch table, say the lunch prayer, it's done. You got it for a long time.
I agree with that. We've always had an open gate policy at our farm too, invite any potential customer out. And that's helped a lot, especially with chefs. One chef in particular in Montrose, it took several years to convince him that he needed to start selling grass-fed beef. And when he finally educated himself about the benefits of grass-fed, why there was no turning around for him. So I encourage all of you to tell your stories. It's a good vehicle.
Excellent. Well, thank you all.